We are coming to the conclusion of our series in the book of Habakkuk. We have learned that when God is silent, it doesn't mean that he's weak. We've learned that God sometimes is engaged in behind the scenes covert operation in the deliverance for his children. We learned that God wants us to have grown folk faith, a faith that supersedes what we always can see, but a faith that is confident in what God says. Today we are ending this book, and if someone comes to you and asks you, do you have a theological understanding of the exegetical principles embedded in the book of Habakkuk? You can answer with the affirmative, yes, I do. You know the book. It is a minor prophet with a major message. And God wants to speak to us once again today, if you would turn. And I want to put this on the screen for us. It was read so ably this morning from the New International Version of the Bible. It should be noted that Habakkuk is not, he is not a preacher of sorts. He is actually a temple musician. God has plucked this musician, has placed on him a burden, and I believe it's so fitting today that Brother Duan is with us, because the entire book really is about encouraging a deeper faith. He is reminding us what faith is really about. He does not write a song in verses in chapters 1 or chapter 2, but in chapter 3, he literally writes a song that has three verses, and here is how he concludes his song. He says, I heard and my heart pounded. My lips quivered at the sound. Decay crept into my bones and my legs trembled. But here's what he learned. Yet, hallelujah, I will wait patiently. Go back for me. One. Here's what he, yet I will wait patiently for the Lord. And go to the next one. For the day of calamity to come on the nation invading us. Then he goes in verse 17. Now here's where he really demonstrates faith. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails, and the fields produce no food. Watch this. Though there are no sheep in the pen, and no cattle in the stalls, yet... Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God, my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread, next slide, on the heights. Then he ends by identifying himself from the director of music on my string instruments. I believe that if, in fact, this musician were to give this song a title, he would entitle this song, When He Does No Miracle. Faith, When He Does No Miracle. Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you would come now into this place. Holy Spirit, I need you right now. It is no coincidence that you are leading this service today. The words that have been spoken and relayed through song want to teach us about a new dimension of God. And today now, as you are growing your people for the end of time, would you teach us how to know, to love, yea, even to trust this God when he does no miracle? Well, this is our prayer today. We ask it and we thank you in Jesus' name. Let God's people say amen. It is a confirmed spiritual truth that early in our Christian experience, God often builds and sustains our faith by allowing us to experience frequently the joy of divine miracles. It is true that the same God who turned the bitter waters at Canaan into the sweet and tantalizing wine at the wedding feast is the same God who has turned some of our bitter disappointments into our sweetest moments of spiritual victory and deliverance. If this were the end of the story, life would be a bed of roses. But there is another spiritual truth that we must grapple with, for it is also true that this same God, when he is maturing us, when he's growing us, when he allows us to have our faith built on the foundation of miracles, is also the same God, when he matures us, who takes us through more obstacles and allows us to experience fewer miracles to test us to see if we are serving God for his blessings or are we serving God for God. You see, you know it's true. Early in your Christian experience, you had few challenges because God was building your faith. You prayed and it happened. You petitioned and it came. You requested and God moved. And what happened subconsciously is you began to appreciate God's hand, but you had little idea how to love his heart. So God says, the only way that I can cause you to love my heart is to introduce you to a God who sometimes does no miracle. Beloved, I remember clearly the time in my life when God began to transition me to this type of faith. I remember early in my bachelor days, I'd acquired the perilous habit of leaving my wallet in places where it could be easily stolen. Now, please, this was not done intentionally. The Lord was highlighting two things for me. First, he was highlighting the fact that I needed to take better care of my belongings. Second, he was highlighting the fact that I needed a wife to help me get my life together. Are you hearing me today? Do I have some brothers in the house who can appreciate what I'm talking about today? He said, I need to hook this brother up because if he does not find a virtuous woman, he's going to lose his head if it's not attached to his body. And so I recall that every time I lost my wallet, I began to pray this routine prayer out of desperation because I knew that I needed God's help. And, you know, when you lose money, you know, you start reminding God of all the righteous deeds you've ever done. I said, God, now listen, you know that I sacrificed a career in law. I had it all planned out. I was going to follow in my father's footsteps. And had I been an attorney, I would be making three times the money that I'm making now. But Father God, I followed the call to ministry. I responded to your voice in faith. And now here I am, God. So God, because of my righteousness and because of the deeds that I've done for you, will you please help me find my wallet? And watch this. Miraculously, every time I lost it, I would find it through some type of miracle. You know it's a miracle when somebody, come on now I need you all to be real with me for a moment. You know it's a miracle when the economy is down and somebody from the hood brings you your wallet back with money in it. Folks, how many can testify that's a miracle? And so I thank God, and I'd come to love and appreciate this God who does miracles. But then one day it happened. I went to a particular area of town playing basketball, and as I was playing, I inadvertently placed my wallet down in a place where I thought it was going to be safe. And, you know, I must have been on fire that day because I literally walked out of the gym and left my wallet sitting there on the bleacher. I was 5 miles down the road, and all of a sudden, you know that feeling you have when your throat drops in your stomach? And your palms begin to sweat, realizing that you left everything. Now, I had everything in the wallet, my driver's license, credit cards. At that time, Palm Pilots were in. So I had a Palm Pilot, all of my addresses, contacts in there. And I immediately began to go into my default mode of praying that desperate prayer. Lord, here I am again. Help a brother out. Here I am. I'm here doing your work, God, doing it your way. And lo and behold, when I walked into the gym, there it was on the bleacher, my wallet. I went to pick it up only to discover that by this time, it was only a wallet. They took my Palm Pilot, took my money, took everything but my driver's license. Who needs a driver's license when you need gas to put in the car to get home? And so I was devastated. Now, maybe it doesn't mean anything to you, you know, because you, you know, big baller, shot caller. You have money just to throw away. But when I was first starting out in ministry, to lose $200, that was a big deal. But I wasn't just hurt because I lost the money. I was hurt because this was the first time I had to encounter a God who does no miracle. Who is this God? I'm accustomed to the God who allows someone to call me on the phone and say, I have seen your driver's license in your wallet. I'm returning your wallet to you and your money back. Where's that God? Now, who is this God when he does no miracle? What do you do when the, hear me, what do you do when the God who has been so good in the past all of a sudden suspiciously changes his course of action and he no longer performs miracles like he used to before? What do you do when that happens? You see, this is what Elijah the Tishbite had to face in 1 Kings, the 17th chapter. The Bible says that Elijah looked into the face of Ahab and declared in no uncertain terms with courage that there will fall neither dew nor rain in the land until I say so. Now, folk, that's a bad dude. When you look into the face of the president and say that there will fall no rain on the United States, not until God says, but until I say it, that's a bad boy. And God, understanding that his life now was in jeopardy, told him to go and to hide in the place that was called Kereth Ravine. And there he was fed by ravens. The Bible says that the ravens fed him bread, and the ravens miraculously fed him meat. And God supplied water from a bubbling brook to quench his thirst. And here he was being obedient to God, but all of a sudden the text says that the brook dries up. The ravens that miraculously fed him stopped coming. The ravens that miraculously brought him bread stopped coming. And what do you do when you're obedient to God and the provision that God provides in your obedience now dry up? What do you do when God, who has worked like this in the times before, now stops working how he's worked before, and now he's saying, you've met the God who blesses you with his hand, but now I want you to know the God who's asking you to trust his heart. What do you do with that God who causes your life all of a sudden to dry up? I mean, instantly. I mean, it just happened just like that. 30 years of marriage, and he says he's walking out. I mean, you stood before the altar. You said for richer or for poorer, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health. And all of a sudden, he starts acting up, and now you know what it's like to have your brook dry up. God could work a miracle, but when he sends you the divorce papers, you recognize that your brook has dried up. I mean, just like that. You've been working for this company for 30 years. And now they tell you that corporate cutbacks are happening, and you just waiting for God. You know, you put the, here you are. You've been anointing your office, putting a blood post on your office, saying that when the death angel comes, that he's going to pass over. And so you know that when the pink slip comes, that certainly it won't come to my office, because I know the God who performs the miracles. But then the pink slip happens, and you recognize what happens when the brook dries up. What do you do with this God? This is the dilemma that Habakkuk finds himself in the third chapter, with the looming Babylonian army posed to strike a devastating blow to the nation of Israel. He asked one last question to ask of God. Put this on the screen, Habakkuk 3 and verse 2 in the New International Version. I want you to see this. Lord, listen to him. He says, I have heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds. Now, he says, here's what I want you to do. Repeat them in our day. In our time, make them known. In other words, where is the God who worked for Israel in the past, and why isn't that God working for us right now? He says, in wrath, remember mercy. Listen, he is so desperate to see God's miraculous hand that he starts rehearsing the miracles of God that he's done in Israel's past. He starts rehearsing the time when Israel was in the hand of God and God told the Red Sea waves to stand like an honor guard as Israel walked through on divine pavement. He starts talking about the time when God sent hornets ahead of Israel to drive out the inhabitants of the land so that Israel could drink from wells that they did not dig and eat from vineyards that they did not plant. He starts talking about the time when God crushed the enemies of Israel and caused kings who were once arrogant to now fall at the feet of Israel in humble submission. And he says, where is that God? He said, that's the God I want. I want to know the God who performs miracles, but where is the God who all of a sudden causes the brook to dry up? Well, beloved, the good news is this. The reality is that if his prayer begins with a question, it is clear that his prayer ends with a faith-filled declaration. For Habakkuk teaches us, listen to me, that when we have to meet the God who does no miracles, it's not an indication that God has abandoned us. It is an indication that God is developing last day faith in us. You see, God, listen to me. You see, God understands that we've been talking about the last days for a long time. Adventists, you better wake up. You better wake up. I know he's saying he, you know, we talked about it in the 60s. He did not come. John Kennedy was the president, the first Catholic president. The church went into an uproar, but he did not come. 70s, we had the gas crisis. He did not come. 80s, we had Ronald Reagan and his issues. He did not come. Bill Clinton in the 90s, he did not come. Now Trump and Obama in the 2000s, he did not come. So maybe we have thought that these are not the last days. You better wake up. The Bible says he's coming like a thief in the night. That's for all of us prophecy-quoting, granola-eating Adventists who believe that you got God into your Rolodex and you believe that you can put him on your Palm Pilot and tell him when he gonna come. Oh, I'm sorry, when he is going to arrive. God says, I'm coming like a thief. He's teaching us last day faith. Because the fact is, beloved, that in the last days, God knows that persecution will break out. In the last days, God knows that nation will rise against nation. In the last days, God knows that kingdom will rise against kingdom. In the last days, God knows that family members will rise against family members. In the last days, he knows that some of you will be called before tribunals and asked to give a reason for the hope that lies within you. And when that time comes, he doesn't need any mamby-pamby Christians who have not been tested and tried. So God says, I'm going to test them now so that they can make it then. See, I need some Christians who will not break. I need some Timex Christians who can take a licking and keep on ticking. I need some folks who are fortified in their faith. And this is what the Bible is clear. I need some people who are satisfied that even if I don't get the stuff that Jesus promised, even if I don't get the material blessings, and even if I don't get the miracles, I'm satisfied with Jesus alone. See, now I understand Jeremiah a lot better, because Jeremiah, the prophet, declared in Lamentations 3:24, he said, listen to this, the Lord is my portion. Woo-hoo. Therefore, I will wait for him. You see, Jeremiah had to meet the God who performed no miracles. And when he met him, he discovered that miracles really weren't the best blessing that God had to offer in the first place. You see, he came thinking that the best thing God had to offer was a miracle. He left realizing the best thing that God had to offer was the master. And if he had the master, then the miracle was secondary. Yeah, you see, he thought that protection was the primary blessing. But when he left, he realized that his presence was the primary blessing. He thought that healing was the blessing. But when he left, he realized that heaven was the blessing. And child of God, Jeremiah left that thing saying, listen, you can keep the houses, you can keep the cars, you can keep the bins, you can keep the mansion. But at the end of the day, just give me Jesus, because the Lord is my portion. Hey, as long as I got Jesus, I don't need anybody else. And I wonder, is there somebody here today who's grateful that once you come to know Jesus, you will discover that Jesus is enough? Woo! I don't care what the doctor says, Jesus is enough. I don't care what the attorney says, Jesus is enough. Even when he does no miracle. So, when we are led to meet this God who performs miracles, listen to me. What type of faith is God developing in us? I want to suggest to you that there are three things that God is leading us to understand from this text. First of all, he is transitioning us from a faith, hear me, that needs a miracle to a faith that satisfied and trusts his decision. Hear me. He's leading us, transitioning us from a faith that needs a miracle. Now, listen, hear me. I'm not saying that God stops performing miracles. I'm saying there's some people who only trust God if he performs a miracle. So God is saying, I need some people who in the end of time will trust my decision and not their perception. Okay, here it is. Let me explain it this way. You see, there are certain songs, hear me, that you cannot sing until you reach a certain level of faith. Are you hearing me today? See, this is why I don't sing. Well, I shouldn't say I don't sing it. I struggle when it's time to sing that song, any way you bless me, Lord, I'll be satisfied. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. Now, you can sing it because I know maybe, you know, you just there. You know, you sprouting wings. I get it. You came to church. You couldn't even get in the door. Your halo was too high. I understand. But I'm just for me and my house, I struggle with that song because there's sometimes when God is growing your faith that he blesses you with obstacles. And the last time I checked, an obstacle doesn't satisfy me. Sometimes, hear me, sometimes God will bless you with persecution, but that doesn't satisfy me. Sometimes he'll bless you with pain, but that doesn't satisfy me. But if we let him, God will grow us to the place where he will teach us to be satisfied with him. Here it is, Habakkuk 3:16. Put that on the screen for us. I want you all to see this in New International Version. See if we can get this, Habakkuk 3:16. Can we get it? Yes, yes. Now what? Listen to his response when he realizes that God has not changed his mind. He says, I heard, and my heart did what? My lips did what? At the sound. Decay crept into my what? And my legs trembled. Then he says, but wait, he hung on to God. Oh, that's a word. That's, oh my God. Listen, that's free. That's free. That's not even in the notes. But he did not stop there. See, the problem is that some of you are stopping on the precipice of your blessing. That's the problem. You're right there. Your legs are trembling, lips are quivering, and you say, I'm going to give up. And God says, you don't understand. There's a revelation on the other side of the wait. But you can't handle it because you think God is a Santa Claus rather than a Savior. So he hung on to God, and then he came to the point where he recognized, but I understand the God now who performs no miracles, so I will wait patiently. Woo. Next slide. Watch this. For the day of calamity. Not the day of blessing. He's this is a bad brother right here. Now you're talking about faith? He said, I will wait for the day of disaster. He said, I got so much trust in God that I can look terror in the face and laugh. I got so much trust in God that I can look foreclosure in the face and declare that my next house is on the way. I got enough faith that I can look cancer in the face and said he can heal me and I can be a testimony, or he can kill me and I can wait on Jesus. Either way, God wins. Hear me. He says, I'll wait patiently. But he also teaches us that when God transitions us, hear me, when he transitions us, it's a difficult process. We don't like it. That's why his lips are quivering, his heart is pounding. Because God, watch this, God is literally weaning him from milk to meat. And nobody likes to be weaned. Now, let me help you out. I remember when we tried to wean my daughter, Alana, from eating primarily from her mother to taking a bottle. You know, we were like, okay, we're tired of being trapped in the house. Come on now. Say, can I? Tired of being trapped in the house. Tired of looking at each other. You know, it got so bad. You know, and parents, only parents can understand this. You know you need to get out when you're walking around the house and all of a sudden you realize you have a Velcro diaper that's attached to your ankle. It's been there. Okay, do I get some parents who have it with? I said, we need to get out of this house. And so we decided that it was time to wean Alana from eating from her mother to now eating from the bottle. And I remember the first time that we gave her the bottle, yo, she looked at us like, are y'all serious? I mean, it's one of those looks like you all are tripping. I mean, like, literally. But we understood, hear me, church, we understood that we had to wean her for her good. And so the first time we gave her the bottle, she responded just like Habakkuk responded. Her lips quivered. Her body started to tremble. Hear me now. Because nobody likes to be weaned. Now watch this. It wasn't that, and I need you to hear me. It wasn't that we were not feeding her. She just did not like the method we were feeding her. Woo. Yeah, she was getting food, but she didn't like the method. Yeah, she was accustomed. See, that's my God. Thank you, Holy Ghost. You see, the problem is God says, I'm feeding you, but you don't like how I'm feeding you. Yeah, you see, because you thought that I should feed you through miracles. But God says, I'm going to feed you through revelation. I'm going to feed you through a deeper faith. She had no problem being sustained, but she did not like the method by which she was being sustained. And so she thought we were punishing her, but we were just weaning her. She thought we were being unfair to her, but we were just weaning her. And the reason that we had to wean her is because we understood that if we did not wean her, there were certain foods that she could never experience and enjoy. So there was a level of culinary delight that she was limited, thank you, God, because she was still on milk, but we wanted to help her to understand what strawberry shortcake tasted like. And so now, watch this, now that she enjoys her lasagna, and now that she enjoys her spaghetti, and now that she enjoys her strawberry shortcake, she understands that we were not weaning her to punish her. We were weaning her because we wanted to give her more. Woo! That's good. You see, that's a word for somebody here today. You see, some of y'all came to church this morning thinking that God was punishing you, but God is just weaning you. Yeah. He's weaning you from a religion that wants his hand, but he's giving you more of a religion that's consumed with his heart. He's weaning you from a religion that needs a miracle and giving you more of a religion that is satisfied with the master. He's weaning you from a religion that needs the dramatic, and he's giving you more of a religion that only needs him. And I wonder, is there anybody here that's grateful that we serve a God who wants to give us more? And he says, I want to give you so much more that I'm willing to wean you even if you don't like it. And if you have to meet the God who does no miracles, so be it. Because I want to teach you that the devil may win the fight, but God always wins the war. He said, I want to teach you the devil may throw the first punch, but God gets the last laugh. I want to teach you that pain is temporary, but heaven, thank God, is forever. And the only way sometimes to take us to that faith is by causing us to meet the God who does no miracle. Does no miracle. So back it says that, but there's another thing that God wants to teach us. Not only is he transitioning me from faith that needs a miracle to faith that's satisfied with his decision, he's also transitioning me from faith that needs the bread for life to faith that lives by the bread of life. Watch this. Write in the text. Put it on the screen. Habakkuk 3:17. Watch this. He said, the brother, now this, folks, this is bad faith. I'm telling you. This is show enough faith. He says, though the fig tree does not bud and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no fruit. Next one. Watch this. Next slide. though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. Now, wait, don't miss this. You must understand the significance of this statement. You see, Judah was primarily an agrarian society. The economy was based on food. And so when he describes a portrait where the figs are no longer producing and the olives are gone, he's literally saying that the grocery store has been emptied out, yet he trusts God. He says, I went to Wegmans, there's no food there. So I tried Save-A-Lot and there was no food there. Then Save-A-Lot didn't have, so I went to Costco to buy in bulk. It was all gone at Costco. There's no food anywhere. People are going to die, yet I will trust in the Lord. In other words, he says, I've come to the place that the joy that I once received from having provisions from food, I now receive that same joy by rejoicing in the Lord. Listen, God wants to take his people to a new dimension of faith where the will of God is just as delicious to you as a gourmet meal. He wants to get you to the place where doing God's will tastes so good that you recognize, man, have I eaten yet? I've been in the Word of God so long feasting on him that I don't even recall the last time I had a sandwich. But I came to realize that I think I enjoy the Word more than I enjoy the sandwich. So it doesn't matter now because I'm rejoicing in the Lord. Yeah. You see, let me help you this way. I want you to pause right now and think about the meal that you have prepared for this Sabbath. You all did prepare a meal. All right. Let me just be real. Okay, for those of you who didn't prepare a meal, think about the restaurant. Looking at me like, prepare a meal? That's old school. Huh? Think about it. Think about that vegetarian lasagna that you cooked that's now marinating and all the juices are now going to the bottom of the pan. The cheese is melted just right on top. Think about it. Think about, for you vegetarians, that dinner roast you bought from Living Well. That's cut up now, just right. For you carnivores, think about that roasted rotisserie chicken that you have. That's roasted just right. The garlic mashed potatoes with the mushroom gravy oozing off the side. Think about it. Think about the sweet potato souffle that you have. That's gooey on the inside but crusty on top with cinnamon. Oh, my goodness, I got to end the sermon early today. Cinnamon on top and brown sugar. Think about it. Think about it. Think about that strawberry shortcake with chocolate drizzled on top and a scoop of Breyers ice cream on the side. Can you smell it? Can you taste it? And God said, when you are sure enough converted, that doing my will taste just as good as the meal you just envisioned. This is why I understand it now. This is why in John, the 4th chapter, that when Jesus was talking to the Samaritan woman, but listen, the Bible says that Jesus got so caught up. He was engaged in conversation with the Samaritan woman that he didn't even remember that he hadn't eaten. Now, the disciples were like, man, listen, we hungry. They are watching a conversion in process. But the Bible study isn't filling enough. So they need food because the Bible isn't enough. So the text says they leave Jesus at the site of a conversion because they have to get some food. And here they are. You can see them when they come back, can't you? You know, grease stains all on the chin, crumbs on the sleeve. And they look at Jesus and they declare these words, Rabbi, have something to eat. And Jesus is looking at them and like, I've been eating ever since you left. And so they're troubled because they're saying, wait a minute, we didn't see Subway, we didn't see a Potbelly's, we didn't see Domino's Pizza. Who fed Jesus? But they failed to recognize that nobody fed Jesus. The only thing that Jesus had was a plate full of the joy of the Lord. And he had a side salad of he is my strength. And God said, that's enough, because watch this, when you know Jesus, There's something that happens where all you need is the Lord. And I wonder if there's somebody here today who wants to come to the place where you can say, all I need is Jesus. Yeah, I know they told me that I needed a brand new car, but all I need is Jesus. They told me I need a new mansion, but all I need is Jesus. They told me I need cash money, but all I need is Jesus, because I've learned to rejoice in him. Learn to rejoice in him. But wait a minute now. There's one more thing that God wants to share. Because not only is he transitioning us from a faith that needs the bread for life to a faith that lives by the bread of life, but he's transitioning me, last one, from finding strength in miracles to now finding joy in the miracle maker. Habakkuk ends in 3:19. Put this on the screen for us. Watch this. He says, man, this is good. The sovereign Lord is my strength. Why? Because he makes my feet like the feet of a deer. Now, don't miss the National Geographic reference. For what Habakkuk is literally telling us, he's referring to what scholars have reminded us is the mountain deer or the hind. And they tell us that the mountain deer is the most sure-footed animal on the place, on the face of the planet. They say the mountain deer, you've seen them before in the mountains. They can run along jagged mountains and they don't slip. But it's not just that they don't slip. What's unique about the mountain deer is that they are stable where other animals stumble. You see, the thing that's unique about the mountain deer is that if an average animal goes on the mountain, they will stumble. But the mountain deer is stable because the Bible says he's sure-footed. Others fall, the deer stands. Others crumble, the deer stands. Because the Bible says that this deer can handle what most deer cannot. See, that's what God is sharing with you today. He says, likewise, when you learn about this God who does no miracle, he says, I will cause you to stand where other people stumble. He says, I'll cause you to have strength where other people are weak. You've seen it before. Your coworker lost their job, lost their mind. You lost your job, come to church praising God. Why? Because God has taught you how to stand. Whew. Where other folks are stumbling. Husband walked out, your coworker stopped popping Prozac pills. Your husband walked out, you say, when you converted, come on back. But in the meantime, I'm taking Jesus on a date. Why? Because you've learned how to be steady, thank you, God, where others stumble. But wait a minute. Then he says, he enables me to tread, next slide, watch this, on the heights. So in other words, what Habakkuk paints is a picture where God takes him from his current perspective and allows him to look at the same problem from a different perspective. The problem hadn't changed, but he's on high, looking down on the problem. Before, he had a bird's, before, he had a level view of the problem, and he couldn't see from God's perspective. But God says, when you learn how to deal with a God who does no miracle, you start to see things from my perspective. You start to see that what the devil meant for evil, God meant for good. You start to see that where you once saw destruction, you now see deliverance because you have a different perspective. You start to see that the thing you thought was killing you now has helped you, because before you only knew the God who performed miracles, but now you've come to know that even when he does nothing, he's always doing something. See, Habakkuk thought God was doing nothing. But he had no idea that God was on the back end of his calamity, working it out. Because Nebuchadnezzar tried to wipe out Judah. But he forgot that there was a promise given that there would one day come a lion from the tribe of Judah. And if Jesus has declared that he will come through the line of Judah, there is nothing that Nebuchadnezzar could do about it, because God is on the throne. And I believe there's somebody here today. You're dealing with a God who it seems like he's doing no miracle. But let me tell you something. He's performing a miracle. He's feeding you. You may not like how he's feeding you, but he's feeding you. He's feeding you. And what he's feeding you is faith for the last days. So when they march you before the tribunal, downtown D.C., and they ask you to give a reason for the hope that lies within you, do you renounce this Sabbath? Do you renounce this remnant theology? Will you stand up for God? And some will crumble because they only knew a God who extracted them from the situation. But for the rest of us, we can say that though the olive does not bud and the fig tree does not bloom, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. Is that your desire today? Listen to the words of this song.
I know that faith is easy when everything is going well. But can you still believe in me when your life's a living hell? And when all the things around you seem to quickly fade away, there's just one thing I really want to know. Will you let go? Will you stand on my word against all odds? Will you believe what I have said? What seems impossible, will you believe? Every promise that I make, will you receive? Yes, I will trust you, Lord. I know how bad it hurt you when that loved one's life came to an end, and when they had to leave you, you said you trust you, Lord.
appeal is threefold today. There's someone here today, God has released you because you came today thinking that he was punishing you. But he's just weaning you. He's just transitioning you from faith that needs milk to faith now that's based on the meat of God's word. He hasn't abandoned you. By the way, we ought to make it clear. God never stopped doing miracles. But Habakkuk no longer needed God to sustain him by a miracle. There's a difference. God is always performing miracles. In fact, the servant of the Lord tells us that in the last days, that there will be unseen heavenly visitants who will extract God's people from danger. But watch this. By the time we reach that point, it doesn't matter if we live or we die, because we've learned to rejoice in the Lord. That's it. So here's my appeal. Someone first today, God is saying, I want to grow you to a new level of faith, but you have to let him. You have to let him. God says, I want to transition you from a faith that always needs a miracle to a faith that trusts the decision of God. And some of you have been struggling with some decisions that God has made. They're different than what you had. But today God is saying, will you trust me? Say, will you trust me? Will you trust me? Then God is saying there's some folks that he wants you to have the same joy in the Lord that you have when you think about food. Now hear me, this is slightly comical, but it's true. We are a people who go crazy over food. I'll never forget the first time I asked our church to engage on a 40-day fast. Looking at me like, fast? What are we fasting for? We fasting from Facebook? No, food. Not a total fast. I just said, listen, this is right. I said, just give up meat. Meat. Give up sugar. Sugar. Two things that are killing us. Because we have this craving for food. But God says, when you're truly converted, here's what happens. That same craving that you have right now to eat, you have that same craving to give someone a Bible study. That same craving that you have now to have that dessert, he said, you have that same craving to minister to the brokenhearted because your joy is in the Lord. Do you want that today? God knows I want that. God knows I want. I need that. Apathy is real, but God says the problem is conversion, not a new program. It's some converted people, some changed people who are rejoicing in Jesus. Hey, when you rejoice in him, some changes. Then finally, he said, yeah, you thought you needed a miracle, but he says, now I'm going to introduce you to the miracle maker. And when you meet the miracle maker, watch this. Hear it. You know, sometimes, listen, when you meet the miracle maker, the miracle is secondary. It's secondary. This is why John the Baptist in the prison, you remember first he thought God was going to give him a miracle. You remember that? God said, no miracle. But then John understood who he had the opportunity to baptize. And when he thought about the privilege that was his in the ministry, he said, even if he does not extract me from prison, I've met the miracle maker. And that's good enough for me. And when Jesus calls the righteous living to hear the trump of God, one of the first persons that will hear the voice will be the voice of John the Baptist. Do you want that kind of faith? Here's what God is asking us to do. There are some decisions God is saying, surrender to me. There, watch this. There is a confession that needs to happen to say, God, I'm not there yet. I value the things of this world more than I value you. And I'm giving you permission to radically reorganize my life for your glory. I'm giving you permission to do that. That's a serious prayer. But watch, when you do it, you rejoice in the Lord. Then finally say, God, I've been focused on stuff. But now I want to be focused on the miracle maker. Other day, the government announced that they're about to begin the process of draining the swamp in Washington. Going to cut back the workforce in D.C. That all of the federal workers that we now have, we don't need. So we're going to trim back. And so there's a likelihood that some of us will experience what is now being prognosticated in the news. But watch this. God has already given you a promise. He says that you can be steady where others stumble. So everybody's now worried. What's going to happen in D.C.? Nothing's going to happen in D.C. God is on the throne. He is running this city. It may not look like it because he's behind the scenes wanting to see, are my people trusting me or my hand? Because you discover, listen, the same God who brought manna down from heaven to feed Israel, the same God who took oil and flour together and fed Elijah, the same God who took a boy's lunch can feed you in the midst of a depression. So don't worry about that stuff. He says, will you trust the miracle maker? And if that's your desire today, just stand. Just stand. God is, he hears you. He hears you today. Thank you, Jesus. Father, in the name of God, today we have come to love. Thank you. We've come to love. Yes, even the God who does no miracle. We've come to love that God. Because that God, thank you, God, is a God who is growing us and preparing us for the last days. So today we've determined, Father, that there are some decisions that you've made in our lives that we don't like. But today we come to you and saying, Father, we surrender it now. We surrender it now. I was hurt then, but I surrender it now. I was upset then, but I surrender it now. And I'm trusting your decision and not the miracle. But second, someone here today, you know that there are some things that you enjoy more than the Lord. There's some things you enjoy more than the Lord. And God is a jealous God. He does not like competition. And today you're saying, God, I'm giving you permission to radically reorganize my life. Oh, and he'll do it. He'll do it. You may not like it, but he's weaning you. And when you come out, you have more of him. Finally, you're saying today, God, I want to meet the miracle maker. So here we stand, God. But there's one more. There's a miracle that's taking place in the building today. For the Spirit of God has touched someone's heart. And they know that today the Spirit of God is calling them to come and to either give their lives again or to give their lives for the first time to Jesus. Where are you? This is our opportunity to minister to you. You need to slide out of your seat today. The Spirit of God is in this place. Where are you? In the balcony, some young person. Today God is saying, come, give your life to me. You've never been baptized before. Or today God is saying, you know it's time. Come back to me. Where are you today? Young man, this call is for you. Young lady, this call is for you. Where are you today? We're about to close. We won't hold long. But the doors of this church are open. The Spirit of God is here. Where are you today? Father, even as this appeal is open, we thank you for teaching us today to love the God, even the God who does no miracle. Because it is that God who is developing end time faith. To know and to love that God is our privilege. And today we thank you. And we bless your name. Let those who believe and accept God's call over their life. Would you say amen? Come on, say amen again. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together and give God some praise for being in his building today. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Presence of God.